I want to explain one thing. Nikki's just done a fabulous job of sketching the problem and the variety of approaches, responses to that problem nationally. And I'm going to focus in on one particular solution that we call the Accelerated Learning Program at the Community College of Baltimore County. But by doing that, I may leave a false impression. I may leave the impression that I think all 100 of you out there should take our program and impose it on your campuses. And I just want to start by saying that is not the truth. I do not. I love our program, and it works very well for us. We have 39 schools nationally that are doing ALP now. None of them are doing it the way we do it. They each have taken it and modified it. So what I'm going to do is talk about our program as a specific example, but I think what's more important is the sort of ideas behind why we developed the program and our thoughts about why the program is as successful as it is. So with that little introduction, let's see if we can, what I'm going to do, my talk is three parts. I'm going to describe a problem that already Francesca started the conversation and Nikki described, and I'll add a little layering onto it. And then I'm going to describe our solution to the problem, and I'm going to present some results of our ALP program that's now in its fifth year. So what's the problem? Well, let me start with this. I've been in the developmental ed business. I'm an English faculty member at Community College of Baltimore County, and I've been there 35 years. Most of that time, there's been maybe one or two semesters when I didn't teach developmental writing, but almost, so that's 70 semesters I've been teaching, or maybe 67. It's the center of my life. It's what I really, really focused on for most of those years. And for me, that's been very satisfying because, I think higher ed has lots of very important missions. I think it's wonderful that we produce doctors and astronauts and dancers and poets, even lawyers. But if your point of view is that you're looking at higher ed as a place that can help with the American dream, that can help with people who for variety of reasons, some of which are their own fault, arrive on our doorstep way behind in the educational process where they can catch up, where they have a chance at the kind of middle class lifestyle that all of our students aspire to. If we're looking at the part of higher ed that makes the greatest contribution to social justice, then DevEd is at the center of that. And so my personal feeling is it's where I put my focus, and I think it's really worth that kind of focus, and I know lots of you have done the same. However, unfortunately, in my view, developmental ed is actually at a sort of tipping point, or maybe a better metaphor is we're in the middle of a perfect storm. And part of that storm is Nikki's fault. CCRC, we produced some data back in the 90s that showed the same kind of things, but when CCRC produces the data, the world listens, and they've produced data that shows that despite all the hard work those of us in the trenches have been doing for 35 years or more or less, the results have been much less than we hoped for. Let me take an example. This is a study I did in the early 90s. I looked at all the students who took development. We have two levels of developmental writing. The upper level developmental writing course at my school, there were 863 students in academic year 88-89. Of those, 57% passed the course. Now, I followed them for 4 years, so this doesn't mean they passed it on their first try, but they passed it eventually. And of those, here's one of the most startling things is this box here. Of those 490 students who passed the course, 135 of them stopped out at that point, never attempted. When I say never, I mean 4 years. Never attempted the credit English course, which for us is English 101. And that really, of all these data, that was the most startling to me. And it made me start thinking, I wonder why that is. Why would students give up? They didn't fail. They actually had a successful experience, but still never went on to the credit course. And then how did they do, those who went to the credit course? Well, 33% of the original cohort actually passed the credit course. When I discovered this in 1992, we crunched these numbers on an Apple IIe computer, by the way. When I discovered this, I shut the computer down and wouldn't let anybody look at it. I was it was horrifying. All of this work we're doing, and two-thirds of the students never succeed in even this minimal goal of passing English 101, never mind AA degrees and certificates and transfer and so forth. Just passing the first credit course, only a third of them did it. So that was, those data were the start of ALP, and it took about 14 years for those data to actually produce a program that addressed that problem. But that's the problem at our school, and it's reflected in all of CCRC's data for the state of Virginia or the state of Florida or the whole Achieving the Dream amalgam of colleges. We're everyone is experiencing that, and that's one of the reasons we're in a perfect storm. But there's also the completion agenda. By the way, these are not the villains, these purple arrows that are diving in. They're not, CCRC is not the villain. We needed to know the truth, and similarly, the completion agenda is putting a lot of pressure on schools, particularly four-year schools, to just not admit developmental students. Just send them to the community colleges. If you get rid of your developmental students at UMass Amherst, your completion rates will go through the ceiling. Maybe they've already done it, I don't know. but without having to change anything, because developmental students are higher risk students. More of them drop out. They have further to go, for crying out loud. So the completion agenda, and it's having that same effect on some community colleges that are beginning to establish a floor and telling some students, we won't let you into our developmental program. You got to go to adult basic education or McDonald's, sometimes we don't have a place to send them. And so both of those things, I think, there are reasons, there are some students that I think we can honestly say, if we do a good job of assessment, which doesn't mean giving them the Accuplacer, if we really assess them, we could say they don't have the ability to benefit from a college education. But to do it for the reason that you want to improve your completion rate seems to me to be bordering on immoral. And finally, there's the financial crisis. I'm sure up here in Massachusetts, you're immune to this, but most of the country, especially at the state and local level, people are experiencing huge financial pressures on state budgets and county budgets. And so if CCRC is saying this thing isn't working very well and you need to find a place to save money, eliminating the thing that isn't working very well is one place where politicians are they've been looking at it for years, but more and more of them are looking at it. So I took a second to talk about this sort of national look at developmental ed, because as Nikki pointed out, we're the center of a lot of attention now, the Gates Foundation and Lumina and Hewlett and Kresge and the federal government and the Department of Labor, for crying out loud, just gave out $35 million, something like that. No, more than that, 78 million, some huge amount of money to states, part of which is to go to developmental ed. The Complete College America gave out $10 million this year. We're the focus of a lot of study and a lot of attention, and I think we have about a five-year window to get it right. And otherwise, the kinds of students that we've spent much of our adult lives working for are going to find the resources. They're shrinking already. California turned away tens of thousands of developmental students last year because they didn't have seats for them. So it's a sort of a triage. So let's go to work. Let's figure out how to fix it. And as Nikki pointed out, there are lots of ways to fix it. What I'm going to talk about today is just one. I want you to see that. And this is one we developed locally in our little community college. You can develop something. Is anybody here from Middlesex? Yeah, you all are doing an ALP in a really creative way, yeah. and much different from ours, but with some of the same principles. I was just talking about you all down in Georgia. Georgia Gwinnett College is going to copy your model. They may be in touch with you. So one of the questions, remember that box where something like 16% of the students who started in our cohort just gave up after they passed the developmental course. I started thinking about ALP, only I didn't know it was going to be ALP, but with this question, why do students drop out? And we've been doing a lot of surveys of our students. Of course, if you try to survey the students who drop out of your developmental courses, your N is going to be very low because it's hard to find them. Their phones are disconnected, they've moved, and then when you find them, they're angry at the school for whatever reason they dropped out and they don't want to talk to you or they don't respond to your email. So it's a hard thing to do. We took a different approach. We've been surveying everybody who's in class the first week of classes. We do it again at the end. And we ask a whole lot of questions, but the one I'm going to talk about right now is a question in which we say, if it should happen by the end of the semester that you would have to drop out of school, which of the following do you think might be a factor in that decision? And we list everything that they've told us over the years. I think we're up to about 23 different factors. And by far, the most common one is financial reasons. That's number one on the hit parade every year. But let me start by saying what I and some of my colleagues thought were factors. They can't write a thesis, or they have sentence fragments. They don't know how to provide concrete examples, problems with subject-verb agreement, or MLA format. No, none of those. Nobody ever said it was anything like that. And Nikki was alluding to this a few minutes ago. Those weren't the reasons that students say that they might drop out. It was financial problems, legal problems, changes at work, car trouble, abusive situation where they're living, medical problems, eviction from their apartments, problems with their children. And we've kind of lumped, they get laid off, we've kind of lumped these under the umbrella, life happens. And that is a major source. You may have noticed on my chart, I didn't have in the bottom part anybody labeled as having failed our English courses. It just said did not succeed, because mostly they didn't fail, mostly they just drop out. In our traditional developmental course, it's typical by Thanksgiving that you're down to about half the number of students that you started with. But there were some other reasons students gave us, that they might become too discouraged, they might lose confidence, they become depressed, they feel isolated, they weren't prepared for the level of work required of them in the college level, they signed up for the wrong courses. And so we sort of lumped these as affective issues. And so those, it seemed to us, were the two major reasons that students were not being successful in our developmental program. And faced with this, my colleagues and I occasionally said, well, is that our problem? I'm an expert on the apostrophe, but I don't know what to do if you get evicted from your apartment. And so for a while we actually were saying, you know, that's not our responsibility. We're English teachers. But one of the things that we've come to see is that not that it was our fault that was going on, that we were losing so many students to those kinds of factors, but that there is something we can do about it. And that's what I'm going to talk about today. What can we do? First of all, let me just show you, this is sort of like some of the diagrams Nikki showed earlier. If you have a developmental program, whether it's reading, writing, or math, and it has three levels, each of these little places where the circles are appearing is an exit point. This is Katie Hearn from Chabot College's term. I love it. And it means that you can lose students at each of those points. The first one right up here, you would lose them because they don't pass the third level course. Then you would lose them because they pass it but don't take the next course, and so forth. If you have a fairly respectable pass rate in each of your courses of about 65%, you'll only get 8% out the end of that pipeline. If you raise it to 75% pass rate, you'll get 18% out at the end. Even a miraculous 85% of your students succeed at every one of those, make it through each of those exit points, you're still only gonna succeed with 38% of the students. And it's this multiplication effect that is the problem. So one of the things we can do is eliminate all those levels. And I was talking to some people during the coffee this morning, and apparently a number of you have done this. Eliminate some of the levels, move them together, so that maybe you only have one level of developmental course, and then you have two exit points. And then you, if you have a 75% pass rate, which is sort of typical, you would get more than half your students through. And even better, if you can somehow eliminate another exit point, if you have a 75% pass rate, 75% of your students will succeed. And so that's what we did with ALP. And now I'm going to explain how that works. When a student arrives on our campus, we use Accuplacer. I'm not proud of it. I've been working for 30 years to try to get it changed, but with no luck. So a student takes the Accuplacer and is told they need a developmental writing course. But they're told there is another option, the ALP program. If the student decides to take the ALP program, then in her first semester, she signs up for an ALP section of English 101, there she is with a little red hat on, where she's joined by seven other developmental students and 12 101 level students and a teacher. Now, one of the things we really like about this is we think one of the reasons that students get sort of demoralized, depressed, discouraged by being placed in developmental education is that it's demoralizing. They're the first kid in their family to go to college, maybe the first kid among their friends, I'm going to college, and then we say, not so fast. You're not really in college. You gotta take these developmental courses. and you can't take most of our credit courses. You have to pass the developmental courses first, and you're going to have to pay for them and work in them and get no credit. And that's kind of discouraging. I'm sure your students have told you how discouraging, or maybe even how infuriating it is for them. So what we've done is change that. And the second thing we do is we take students who are weak writers or weak mathematicians and put them in a section with a whole bunch of other weak writers or weak mathematicians or weak readers. Well, ALP doesn't do either of those things. We let the student into credit English, and we put them in a heterogeneous section where more than half the students are actually stronger writers. Not that all the 101 level students, but some of them are pretty good writers. And so with all the kind of peer group work and cooperative work we do, there are some good, strong role models in that class for them to interact with and learn from. So that's the student signs up for that section. By the way, the number 8 that we're using, 8 developmental students up here, that's what we've come up with. We were the lowest size of any school in the country until last week, and the Georgia Coastal College in Brunswick, Georgia, has a class size of 5. I don't know how they're paying for it, but they did. But our only sort of guideline on this is that we think that 101 class should be more than half 101 level students to keep it honest. The same semester, that same student also signs up for a developmental course. And there she's joined by the same 7 other students and the same instructor. So here's another reason we think our program works so well, and that is that those 8 students and that instructor spend 6 hours a week together, half of that time in this very small section. It means you can tailor the instruction to exactly the needs of those 8 students. It means that those 8 students and that instructor get to know each other really well. The engagement, the attachment of those students to the college becomes greatly enhanced by this experience. It's an idea we stole from learning communities and also from the studio approach that started at the University of South Carolina of having extremely small sections. And so here, and it also means that the sort of psychology of the developmental course, the way students think about it, is just transformed automatically. What traditionally students see the traditional developmental course as something that they resent. After all, my high school teacher always told me I was a good writer. Why do I need this course? I was in honors English in high school, some of my students tell me. Why do I need developmental English? And mainly they see it as a barrier, an obstacle between them and where they want to be in English 101. That changes completely under ALP. The students in the ALP section really see it as something that's helping them to pass 101 because they're taking it concurrently. We never have to say in the ALP section, pay attention, this will be very helpful next semester when you're in 101. They're in 101, and it's very helpful right then. So what do we do in an ALP class? Well, we conduct it as a writing workshop. The instructor's goal is to do whatever seems appropriate to help those 8 students pass 101. We do lots of answering of questions, lots of writing, particularly short writing papers. We do lots of discussing of ideas, lots of reviewing of drafts of essays. We do work on reducing the frequency and severity of error in our students' writing. And finally, the last 2 are something unusual. We actually consciously spend time trying to talk about those life issues and those affective issues. We actually have a roster of consultants we can bring into the classroom. If 2 or 3 students are having trouble with financial aid or with credit card debt or with trying to get health care for their kids, we'll bring somebody in who's volunteered to work on that and spend some time. We also have little activities we do in class designed to get students to focus on those kinds of issues and those kinds of questions. We have some really wonderful, we're developing right now, some wonderful little short financial literacy modules in which we ask them to do a little research and write something that would help them understand credit card debt and compound interest and things like that. Some of the English faculty are also learning something from this. Remember I said at the beginning, that's our model. We don't think anybody should just take our model and adapt it and adopt it in whole cloth on their campus. But we do sort of think of these 4 as sort of guiding guidelines, what else would guidelines do besides guide for organizing something that we would think of as an ALP course? Students register for credit English and developmental English in the same semester. In the credit English class, the ALP students make up no more than half the class. The same group of ALP students take both classes with the same instructor, and the ALP class consciously addresses life issues and affective issues. And there are lots of ways to meet those four guidelines. So how about results? At the top of this chart, I will show data for students who go through the traditional developmental course, and at the bottom, the ALP course. The data I'm about to present have immense credibility because they were produced by Nikki Edgecombe and Davis Jenkins from CCRC. They were based on our first three semesters, fall of 07 and spring and fall of 08. So the number is a little small. That's why this coming spring they're going to do a follow-up study for us. We can hardly wait. They're wonderful folks, by the way. If you don't have the resources, as we didn't, to do this kind of study, if they do it for you, it not only do they do a really rigorous job, but everybody believes them. All right. So in those three semesters, the number of students who took our traditional course was 2,070, and of those, 69% passed. Their study followed them for 3 years, not four. And for ALP, there were 104 students in the study, and 82% passed. So you can see there's a 13% improvement in pass rates for the developmental course. But what's really interesting is when you look at the next exit point, and it's this statistic here. Remember, back in 1992, I found the same thing with my very rudimentary research tools, including that Apple IIe computer. But they also found 15% of the students of the original cohort passed the developmental course and dropped out at that point, never attempted English 101. Now, I'm up here today, obviously, because ALP does a better job than our traditional course. How much better? 15% in that box, and how much do you think we were able to reduce that for the ALP students? Anybody think we cut it in half? Less than that? How much? Did I hear somebody say zero? Yeah, it's zero. No students leak out of the pipeline because they can't, because they take the two courses simultaneously. They have to register for both, and they have to stay enrolled in both for the entire semester. So right away, we're going to improve our success rate by 15%, even if we're lousy teachers. It has nothing to do with us. It's just this new structure. And that has borne out to be the case. And then how many pass? Remember, for a traditional course, 40% pass, and for ALP, it's almost double, 75% pass. When we saw these kinds of numbers the first couple of semesters, we didn't give talks at conference. We didn't believe them ourselves, and we said nobody will believe these kinds of results, but there they are. And furthermore, we've been getting those results semester after semester. Now, the figures here are lower. These are now intern. CCRC only studied the first three semesters. I'm going to show you something like seven semesters worth of data. But we, in our studies, we include all the students who were there the first week of classes. CCRC eliminated students who were taking these courses for the second time. So because they're higher risk students, and they limited that variable. So our results are a little lower. Instead of 75%, we're in the mid 60s. But you'll see we're in the mid 60s pretty much every semester. I was on sabbatical, I should say, in spring of 08. That's not true. And then sometimes people ask, well, yeah, but maybe you talked about all that bonding between those eight students and that instructor. Maybe those instructors cut them some slack and passed them in 101 when they shouldn't. So let's move the chart over to the left and take a look at how they do in English 102. At our school, a required course in all of our AA programs and many of our certificate, but not all of our certificate programs. So what we found is the percentage improvement is even more than doubled now. And again, these are our data, not CCRC's. It's now 36% versus 15% for attempting English 102, and for passing it, 24% of the original ALP cohort and only 10% of the traditional cohort passed. So it appears that they are actually quite, they're doing, in 102, the instructor doesn't know them they're not, they don't even know they were ALP students, and they seem to be doing much, much better than the students that go the traditional route. Finally, Nikki was talking about the problem of, well, okay, lots of innovations, learning communities, IBEST, Digital Bridge, show some sometimes remarkable improvement in the year the students are in the innovation, and maybe a little bit but less the next year, and then it just sort of fades away. So we're really, we were eagerly awaiting, and this September we got our first longitudinal data comparing ALP students with students who went the traditional route. After 1 year, 11% of the traditional students had accumulated at least 15 credits, and 24% of the ALP students had. And after 2 years, 12% of the traditional students had 30 or more credits, and 24% of the ALP. So it appears that that sort of doubling of success rates is continuing 1 and 2 years down the road. These are very tentative, preliminary data. The numbers are not huge, but we're based on these data we produced, CCRC is going to do that longitudinal study for us this spring. Finally, I wanted to mention, we started out with just 5 sections a semester. Remember, there's 8 students in a section. So the first year, we reached 80 students. The next year, 160, then 320, then 640. This year, we're running 80 sections of ALP every semester, and that's 1,280 students. We've found this growth rate about all we can manage. There's several things that have, in fact, next year we're not going to double again. We're going to only go up by 50% because of classroom space and because of faculty development needs. I mentioned there are 39 schools. There's Middlesex in the top of the right-hand column. There's 39 schools nationwide that are trying various forms of something like ALP. And that brings me to the end of my presentation.